Grab somebody's hand all over the building. Hallelujah. All over the building. The Lord is good and greatly to be praised. 3,000 people gathered together in one place on yesterday, covered in orange. And for almost 3 hours stood up on their feet and screamed at the top of their lungs. I wasn't there, didn't have a ticket. Shame on y'all. But I was in my home covered in orange for almost 3 hours with my sons screaming at the top of my lungs. People were in sports bars all across the city spilling their Heinekens, their Blue Moons for the Cheap Brothers, the Colt 45s. Covered in orange, standing up 3 hours, screaming at the top of their lungs. I'm a Vol fan, but I will never stand up for a football team longer than I'll stand up for my God. And I may bleed orange, but I'm covered with red blood. So I wonder if there's anybody here that knows that you have made touchdown after touchdown because God has been blocking for you. He blocked cancer from entering into your body. He blocked HIV and AIDS for getting into your body. 17 of you should have did a back handspring right there. He blocked the creditors from foreclosing on your home. He blocked the devil from destroying your children. I need about 700 of us to thank God right now because he's been blocking for you. Excuse me, I feel like something about to happen. Look down your roll and tell him, excuse me as I shout, but God's been blocking for me. He kept the devil off my family. He kept witches out my house. He kept spirits from destroying my body. Lift up your voice, open up your mouth, and give God praise because he's been blocking for you. He's been blocking for you. So we're going to get into the word. I just sense that y'all been holding back a little bit. Don't let the nest mess you out. Don't let the ego mess you up. I feel like that there's something that God has been wanting from us, and we've been waiting for him to do something. He's already done enough. If it had not been for the Lord on your side, where would you be? Grab somebody's hand really quickly. Let's pray. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you. Yes, Lord. And behold.
To behold you as my King.
Come on, let's worship him.
For your glory.
I will do anything.
I will do anything just to see you.
And behold you as.
To behold you as my King.
One more time, lift your voices.
For your glory.
Yes, God.
I will do anything just to see you.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for the hand that I hold even right now. Thank you, Lord, that the anointing of God is resting upon the hand that I hold. That the devil's weapons will not work on their lives. That the enemy's strategies will not be victorious over their lives. Squeeze that hand, my brother, sister. I squeeze a fresh anointing into the house, into the hand that I hold. I squeeze a new joy and expectation into the hand that I hold. You will not give up. You will not quit. You will not throw in the towel. You will press on towards the mark of the higher calling. You were born to win. So, Father, right now we give you praise because what the enemy meant for evil, you're turning it around. And you're making it work out for my brother and my sister's life for their good. Thank you, Jesus, that although the enemy tried to keep us out of church today, tried to keep us from coming, getting this revelation, getting this word, you helped us push through and press through. And now we're here. And we're going to chase you like never before. We're going to worship you because we know that you're worth it. We're going to praise you in the midst of our circumstances because there's none like you in all the earth. So, Father, right now, hollow out just a few minutes of your time and speak to your people. And as you sow the word of God into them, prepare them to walk the word out. We believe it to be done. It is so. And so it is in Jesus' name. Amen. Hug three people and tell them, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. You may be seated. Well, just remain standing just for a moment. Go ahead and take me to my scripture. Remain standing just for a moment. Take me to my scriptures. Everyone standing, look straight at the screen and then you can sit down. Next time you stand, it's on you. We're just going to honor the word of the Lord. Hast thou not known? Have thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he fainteth not, neither is he weary. Tell somebody beside you, God is not tired. There is no searching of his understanding. He gives power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. Y'all ready? But they that wait upon their Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Let's say that one more time together. Let's say it as loud as you can. Thank you so much, musicians. But they that I lied to you. Let's say it one more time as loud as you can. I lied to you right here in church. Let's say it right here in church. I lied to you right here in the pulpit. I lied to you. We're going to say it one more time as boisterous as possible. Pretend you're at Neyland Stadium. But they that they shall do what? Hold on a second. Let me mount. Let me mount up. They shall mount up with what? As what? They shall run. They shall. Amen. Touch somebody and tell them, get your eagle on. Yeah, tell them that. Just, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want you to thank God for our gifts that the Lord has placed in our body. I want you to thank God for Adam Henry. I was meeting with our creative team about a month ago, and I said, I want to do a series. I want to do a series on eagles. I want to do a series on the anointing of an eagle. And I said to Adam, I want you to think through some of the things, creative things that potentially I could do to be able to illustrate this series so that people might be able to take it home and in a practical sense may be able to use it. And so the creative team began to iron, sharpeneth iron, and they came up with this concept. Why is it? Why don't we simply create a nest and you preach from the nest for 6 to 8 weeks? I don't know if that was for them to illustrate the reality that God calls us to certain things from a homiletical perspective so that we might understand biblical truths through simple things like this nest. Or I don't know if they was trying to keep me standing in one spot for 8 weeks. But whatever it is, did not the Lord bless the man of God through this wonderful illustration? Oftentimes, God speaks to us about divine theological truths that are sometimes too difficult for us to understand cognitively, intellectually, and academically, because it's spiritual, it's high. Certain things you cannot comprehend academically. It doesn't matter what your GPA is, it doesn't matter what your IQ is, it doesn't matter how well you did in school. You could have graduated summa cum laude, but spiritual things have to be discerned spiritually. And so you have to have a prayer life. You have to have some sense of spiritual formation and to dwell in the presence of God in order to understand certain things, because we serve a finite, a infinite God, and we have finite mindsets as it pertains to us. Us biologically, our minds can only perceive or conceive or receive so much illustration and information. And so God is so good to us that even when he has high doctrinal truths, theological truths, heavy, weighty theological revelations, he's so good to us as a good father that he has the ability to break things down for us to understand it. For those of you that are preachers and fivefold ministry leaders, please hear me. I've been doing this for 25 years now, and I went through every stage as an immature preacher. I wanted people to think that I was deep and wonderful, and I did not care whether people got the revelation or not, as long as they walked away saying he's a deep preacher. But as you get older, you understand it is not so as much as important about what you know as it is that the people understand what you're saying. And so my challenge for years has been to make sure that the word of God is simplified, that every person in this place may be able to understand perhaps a very heavy theological truth, but you'll be able to leave and you'll be able to articulate it to others and practically walk it out as though you were a five-year-old. That's been my challenge. That's what the Holy Spirit has challenged me to do for years, is to simplify sometimes deep revelation. And that is what I want to do through this particular series. That's what God does. God loves you so much that he takes a heavy, deep revelation and he chews it up in bite-sized pieces so that you might understand who he is. But this particular series is not necessarily about you understanding who God is. This particular story is about you understanding who you are. You see, if the enemy can keep you blinded to who you are, he can keep you living a low life. The reason I am standing up here on this platform far above you is to try to get one principle in your spirit. If you don't get anything else, if you fall asleep the rest of the series, that's fine. This is what I want you to understand, that God never created you to live a low life. If you're quiet because this world has trained you to think buy here, pay here, check in the cash, WIC voucher. This world has trained you to believe that you are the least of these. This world has taught you to be insignificant and not used by God. This world makes you want to always look at your past. But let me ask you a question. When was the last time God asked to look at your past to fast forward you into your future? He does not need your past to co-sign on your future. God has called you to live the high life. I dare somebody just to shout that God has called me to live the high life. Would you prophesy that to three people beside you and tell them, I'm going to the next level with you or without you. He has called you to live the high life. You do not have to live from paycheck to paycheck. That was for about six of you all. I said you do not have to live from paycheck to paycheck. You do not have to always buy a beat up car. You do not have to always get your vehicle from buy here, pay here. You do not have to always compromise your body to get your bill paid. The devil is a liar. God has called you to live the high life. He loves us so much that he speaks to us in anthropomorphic terminology many times. He speaks to us through homilies. He speaks to us through word pictures. He speaks to us through illustrations. He speaks to us through similes. He says stuff like this: you are a city that is set upon a hill that cannot be hid. When Jesus says that, he's not saying you're really a city. He's trying to illustrate that you are high above where everybody else is, that you are the government of this earth. I don't know who you're voting for. My prayer is that you're voting for the right person, if there's a right person in this one. But I do want you to understand that no matter who gets in the office, it does not mean that this world is going to fall apart, because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell thereof. That means you're supposed to go vote, but understand, don't lose your mind. Don't go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. Don't slit your wrist because the person you voted for didn't get in. God is still high upon the throne. He is still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are a city that is set upon a hill that cannot be hid. The Bible says that you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt is lost its savor, where shall it be salted? It's good for nothing but to be thrown down and cast upon the feet of men. What he is trying to teach us is that we're not really salt. It's an illustration. It's an allegory. It's a homiletical piece that he's trying to teach us. You're not really salt, but you do what salt does. You influence things. You bring preservation to this world. You bring seasoning to whoever God puts in your life. Touch your neighbor and tell them, you're better because you sat next to me. Bump somebody and tell them, I put flavor in your life this morning. You are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. God said it this way. God said it this way. You are the apple of my eye. You're the apple of my eye. Oh, it's hard to get happy up here because I don't know how sturdy this thing is, but you are the apple of my eye. He's not really calling you an apple. He's calling you fruit. His eye speaks of vision. He says, you are the fruit of my expectation. When God wakes up, if God could wake up, he doesn't wake up because he never sleeps nor slumbers. But if God wakes up, he woke up thinking about you. He says you are the apple of his eye. All the way through scripture, he speaks to us through allegories, through similes, through analogies. He says, ye are the sheep of my pasture. Remember Psalms 23. Psalms 23 talks about the Lord is my shepherd. He illustrates us as sheep. He says to them in Luke, the 10th chapter, he says, behold, I send you as sheep among wolves. The reason he is calling us sheep is because sheep are dumb. Sheep are dumb. I know you have a degree on the wall. I know you got a PhD. I know you're working on your dissertation. I know everybody thinks that you are intellectually inclined, but according to the scriptures, the Bible says you are dumb. Sheep don't have paws. Sheep don't have claws. Sheep don't have jaws. They're not very fast. The only defense mechanism that the sheep has against its wolves, its lions, its bears, is its cry. It's cry. So when the bear comes, when the sheep, the lion comes, when the coyote comes against the sheep, the only thing he can do to fight his way out of it is cry for his shepherd. You see, your neighbor has been trying to get you to stay quiet all service long, but they don't know how many lions and back bears and tigers, oh no, have been attacking your life all week long. I dare some of you that's been going through hell and high water, just open up your mouth and cry right now, because when you cry, your shepherd keeps running to your rescue. He gives these illustrations, these allegories. He calls us sheep. But then here in this particular passage, he calls us eagles. I'm laying foundation today. I'm really going to start teaching next week. I just need to lay some foundation today. He calls us eagles. He's saying that we have the same attributes of an eagle, the same characteristics of an eagle, the same anointing as an eagle, the same attitude as an eagle, the same personality as an eagle. He doesn't just do it in this particular passage. He does it in Deuteronomy 32. Let me read it. It says, as an eagle stirs up her nest, fluttering over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them up on her wings, so the Lord alone did lead us. He likens us to eagles. He likens us to eagles. In Matthew 24, the Bible says, whithersoever the carcass is, there shall also the eagles be gathered together. And here in this particular passage, Isaiah the 40th chapter, verse 31, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as what?
Eagles.
As eagles. You're sitting next to an eagle. You're sitting next to an eagle. The same attributes that God put inside of an eagle, it's the same attributes that he put inside of you. And so if we can discern the attributes of this particular bird that is up here, this eagle that is up here, then you'll be able to know more about you. Look at the eagle's eyes. Look at the eyes of this particular eagle. The retina, the eyeball is huge, and there's a reason why the eyes are so huge, because this bird can see over 50 miles from where it is. You didn't hear what I just said. If you would have heard what I just said, you would have knocked somebody's head off. I'm trying to tell you, this bird has the ability to see over 50 miles from where he is. No, listen to me. I live a little bit west of here, and from my house to Chattanooga, Tennessee is 107 miles. This bird has the ability to see, have vision for up to 50 miles. That means that this bird has the ability, if it's standing on my rooftop at my house, has the ability to see halfway to Chattanooga. It can see a small bird. It can see a fish. It can see a snake from here to halfway to Chattanooga. Why would God say that we are like eagles? Because we have the eyesight of an eagle. Some of y'all are like, what you talking about, man? I'm wearing glasses and contacts, and I need a magnifying glass. I'm not talking about in the natural. I'm talking about in the spirit realm, family. God told me to tell you today that you have the vision of an eagle. Y'all not listening to me. You're not listening to me. When he created us, yes, my brothers and sisters, with eyes, yes, with retina, yes, with natural eyes. But the greatest thing that God has given the body of Christ is vision. It's vision. The Bible says, according to Proverbs, according to Habakkuk, write the vision, make it plain. Habakkuk 2 and 2, it says, write the vision, make it plain. The book of Proverbs says it like this. It says, where there is no vision, the people will perish. The book of Corinthians says that Paul has blinded the eyes of those that don't believe so that they might not be able to see the illumination of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is in the book of Judges, the 16th chapter, that the Bible says that when Samson was raising havoc amongst the Philistines, that you know what they did after they cut his hair? The moment they cut his hair is they plucked his eyes out, because they didn't want him to have vision, because the enemy knows that if you can get your vision back, you can get your strength back. Lord, I don't know who I'm talking to today, but my prayer is that the next 30 or 27 minutes that I have with you today, that I can get your vision back. That you will start thinking about things that you used to think about before life hit you. That you will begin to dream again. That you will begin to think bigger than where you are right now. The enemy is trying his best to steal your vision, but the devil is a liar. Today, I decree and declare that at least 300 of you that will receive it today, you're going to get your vision back. Quit paying for another car. Quit praying for another house. Quit praying to be married by July. You need to open up your mouth and say, God, give me my vision back. I'm tired of thinking about things that I should have been thinking about 20 years ago. I want to walk in the vision of the Lord. I want to see things like you see things. I want to believe like you believe. I want to walk in the steps that you have ordained for my life. Don't allow the enemy to take your vision. Let him have the car. You can get another car. Let him have the house. You can get another house. Let him have that man. He wasn't no good for you anyway. Let him have that woman. She was just taking your money. But don't allow the enemy to take your vision. 50 miles, Donna, 50 miles. This dude can see 50 miles from where he is standing. 50 miles. In other words, family, he's 50 miles away from where he wants to be, but he can still see it. Y'all real slow today. You didn't hear what, bros, will you please hear me? I'm trying to help him. 50 miles from, it will take me 45 minutes, 50 minutes to get to Athens, Tennessee. And guess what? He can see where I'm trying to go. Now, there are other birds that see him up on this perch. He's staring off into the distance. Looks like that he has no idea what he's looking at. Looks like he's crazy because he's looking beyond what everybody else could see. You see, buzzards can only see what's right in front of them. Crows can only see what's right in front of them. Pigeons can only see what's right in front of them. But when they look at us, they think we're crazy because we're staring off into the distance. It's not that we are crazy. We can see what other no-name knucklehead birds can't see. Lord, I feel like running, but I don't know if I can run up here. Look at somebody and ask them, do you see what I see? Because you cannot be where you first cannot see. And I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but I'm preaching to somebody. You ain't graduated yet, but you see yourself walking across that stage. You're not married yet, but you see yourself in a long white dress. You are still walking, but you see yourself driving. Is there anybody here that sees something that can't nobody? I can't get nobody to help me. Open up your mouth and tell them, I see something. I see something. No, tell three people beside you, I see something. I see something. That's why I'm shouting this morning. That's why I'm running this morning. That's why I'm praising God this morning. I'm not praising God because of where I am. I'm praising God because of where I see he's about to take me. 50 miles away. Excuse me, but I see something. I see some of y'all about to write a book, and it's going to be a bestseller. I see some of you are about to start a business, and it's about to blow up from the flow up. I see some of y'all about to raise children. They're about to be doctors and lawyers. Y'all ain't talking to me today. I see somebody stepping out of their disaster right into their destiny, and you ain't looking back to see who's gonna push you along. The devil is a liar. I see something over your life. 50 miles. You will never be what you cannot see. You will never be what you cannot see. That's why the enemy is trying to blind you. He's after your eyesight. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but where are my singles? I want you to start changing how you're dating people. You got to start dating people that don't have good insight but got good eyesight. Preach, Earl Arnold. I'm doing the best I can. You see, I'm not one of those guys to tell you, make sure that you marry somebody that's got the whole lot of money and a real nice car. No. I'm not telling you to date somebody based upon their vehicle. You need to date somebody based upon their vision. You ain't got to have nothing, but you do have to want something. Can I get a witness of ain't nobody talking to me because you still dating people that don't want nothing. Can I get a witness? You still letting them use your car all day long while you at work and they at your house eating all your groceries up, picking you up for late. You mad because I'm dogging the person that you with because they ain't got no. You've got to have some vision. Tell somebody, I got to have some vision. I got to have some vision. I got to have some vision. The Bible says, according to the book of Proverbs, he who leadeth himself is being led by a fool. I got to have some vision. I got to walk with some people that's been where I'm going. I've got to have some vision. I've got to be around people that want to do more than have a couple of hours of service and eat a chicken dinner. No, I want to change the city. I want to be around visionaries. I want to open up businesses all over East Knoxville. You see, you see it as a crack house. I see it as something we can renovate and put homeless people in. See, I want to see some people that's got some vision. You see them as a dope dealer. I see them as a pharmacist. You see him as a gangbanger. I see him as the chief of police. You got to have more vision than that. I may be in the apartment, but I see myself owning properties. You've got to see something. 50 miles. He can see out of these eyes for 50 miles. Look at the wings on this bird. What is interesting about this particular rendition of the eagle is it's not that much exaggerated. Adam did not exaggerate this so that you might be able to see it better. It's literally about this size. No, it ain't. I say it is. No, it ain't. I say it is. What the reason you don't think it is because you've never got high enough to see an eagle. I'm not shouting today. I'm just talking to you. You see, you got to get. As long as you're down here, you think it's small. But when you get to the proper place, you'll see how big I really am. Are you listening to me? The wingspan of an eagle family is approximately 9 feet. It's almost a basketball goal. Nine feet. That's a big bird. 9 feet. But it's necessary for him to make it to his destiny. You can't have small wings and get to where God wants you to be. You see, you've been hanging with chicken wing people when God trying to give you. Why everybody quiet? Do I need to duck? I mean, do I need the armor bearers to slip me out of here? Touch somebody and tell them, quit hanging around with chicken wing people. You see, I don't. It takes a long time. It takes a long time for you to grow these type of wings. Chicken wings, you can get them right off the kitty menu. Takes a long time for you to grow these type of wings. They're 9 feet, family, 9 feet long. You have to have that type of wingspan to be able to endure what God wants you to go through. You see, these wings are necessary, y'all. 7,500 feathers cover this bird. 7,500 feathers. 7,500 feathers cover an eagle with the wingspan of 9 feet long. This nest here is not exaggerated either. An eagle's nest really is this big, because you got to have a big nest when you're expecting to birth some big stuff. Never mind, I'll get you there in 3 weeks. 3 weeks, I'm going to talk about that in 3 weeks. I'm sorry, I got off land and cut across the grass, but I had to, I'm sorry, did I say that in front of the cap? But anyway, three weeks, we're going to talk about this nest. 9 feet long. You know why you got to have 9 feet long wings? Because when an eagle is born, he's not even born in low places. This bird has no idea what it means to be in low places. When she's born, she wasn't created to live in low places. She was born in a high place. And the reason she's created and he's created to live in a high place is because the only time an eagle comes down is to devour something that should be up under his feet in the first place. Let me say this just in case I run out of time. Let me say this just in case I run out of time. But I think about 17 of you need to hear this. This eagle has a whole lot of enemies, but none of the enemies of this eagle are bigger than the eagle. That's what gets me. I live out in the Harden Valley, and eagles are first cousins to hawks. And when you see hawks fighting, you know what they fighting with? Pigeons, mockingbirds, crows. But you've never seen them fight for long. Because although the crows and the mockingbirds and the pigeons are constantly picking at them, they don't get so distracted by the little birds that they forget who they are. Lord, this is about to bless 16 of you. When a crow and a pigeon and a buzzard picks at this eagle does not go at. This eagle goes up. Ain't nobody gonna clap on this because you got your mama attitude. So no. You wanna go at them. You wanna go at them. When they Facebook and post crazy stuff on you, you wanna post back. When they tweet on you, you wanna tweet back. But what you learn from the eagle today, eagles don't go at, they go up. And the reason they go up, it's because they're going up to an altitude where crows and pigeons cannot live. And as a matter of fact, that's the reason crows and pigeons are always messing with them, because they really want to be where they are. Can I preach to about three people that are in this place that you today you're going to get delivered from other people's opinions about you? I don't care what they say about you. I don't care what they tweet about you. I don't care what they lie on you about. You ain't going out. You going. Tell three people, go up, go up, go up, go up, go up. There is a place where you can go in God where can't no devil, no demon, no witch, no spirit, no liar, no hater survive in that atmosphere. I need us to take 10 seconds and just go up in the spirit until every buzzard that's been trying to attack you has to die. Excuse me, I know I'm getting happy, but I just thought about some crows that just died because we went up. They can't make it up there. If you don't take it from me, take it from Michelle Obama. When they go low, and I don't endorse that, I just said it. When they go low, we go high. So we're not cussing people out because they said something crazy to us. You're too saved for that. Tell somebody you're too saved for that. No, you're not going to put no Snickers in nobody's gas tank because they said something about you. You're not fighting on no man that really didn't want you. And we're not going to do that. We're not going to do that. When the enemy goes low, we go high. Because Satan cannot handle that type of atmosphere. Are you listening to me? I've got to go. I only have 11 minutes. 9 feet long. That this eagle is born for high atmospheres. For high environments. When Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans and portions of Mississippi, some of Texas, everything went under. Everything died. People were dying and animals were dying. Everything was just dying. Everything was just underwater. But there's an interesting sight. I watched it on YouTube. Is that when the hurricane was coming and the media told everybody to get out, everybody was leaving the city running from the storm, but eagles were flying to it. Did you hear what I just said? Everybody and everything was running from the storm, but eagles were flying to it. Well, why in the world would an eagle fly to a storm? Because eagles understand that they have destiny. And they don't have enough strength to flap themselves into their destiny. So what they do is look for storms. And they look for storms that have high pressure winds. And instead of flying from the storm, they get over the storm, stretch out their wings, and without flapping, the storm takes them to their destiny. This good word today, I'm trying to figure out why y'all ain't wrote me a $250 million check by now, threw it on the altar. Tell somebody beside you, the storm's gonna take me to my destiny. You didn't do it. Touch somebody else and tell them the storm's gonna take me to my destiny. You see, you've got too much word in you, and you've given God too much worship, and you planted too many seeds for you to buckle your knees and run from storms. The devil is a liar. You got enough God beneath your wings right now that you can look a storm right in his face and say, storm, I ain't running from you. I'm running to you, because if it had not been for the storm that I went through, I wouldn't be in my destiny right now. Tell somebody beside you, you needed that storm. If you hadn't gone through that divorce, you wouldn't pray like you prayed. If you hadn't gone through that sickness, you wouldn't run like you run. If them people hadn't lied on you like that, you wouldn't have known that God was good to you. If you would have had food in your cupboard all the time, you wouldn't have known that he was Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God, your provider. You need to thank God for your Look down your roll and tell him, I thank him for the storms. Please stop this. My time is almost gone. Go on and shout, baby. They don't get it. They don't know why you're shouting. Because they see you flying, but they don't know the storm that you had to go through to get there. They see you driving good, but they don't remember your bus stop days. They see you strong and healthy, but they don't remember the times you was in ICU. Go on and shout, baby. Because you're on a high place now, but it took a storm to get you there. Tell somebody, this is a storm shout. This is a storm shout. This is a storm praise. This is a storm leap. This is a storm hallelujah. This is a storm thank you Jesus. I'm not shouting because I got a whole lot of money. I'm not shouting. shouting because ain't nobody getting on my nerves. I'm not shouting because I got Huxtable kids. I'm shouting because although I was in the storm didn't get in me.
Please. Please be seated. If you start shouting like that, it's going to get contagious. If you keep on praising them like that, you know when praises go up, blessings come down. Don't you shout like that. If you shout, God going to fool around and slip through the back door of your life and open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room to receive. Go on and forget it. Y'all go on and take you a 30-second storm break. Why y'all clapping? Wait, hold it. Let me tell y'all why you need to stop clapping. You better stop clapping because of Revelation 1. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And he has made us both kings and priests. Stop clapping. Because he has made you a king, and when kings clap, their servants bring them things. If you keep clapping, God's gonna have some angels serve you and bring some things to your house that you need. All right, I'm through. Today, I'm gonna give back some time. Hold it, everyone stand. I'm giving back some time today. Everyone stand. Y'all are the most disobedient church ever. See, that's why I won't join this church, because you won't act right. Well, forget it. Come on, Ty. We might well go on and praise him. When I think about Jesus, I can... Come on. When I think about Jesus, I can dance. You better get your eagle on, man. I got to go. I got to get this time back. I got to be preaching at another church in a little more than an hour. But when I think about Jesus, whithersoever. The carcass is. Whithersoever the carcass is. Whithersoever the carcass is, Matthew 24, whithersoever the carcass is, there shall also the eagles be gathered together. Whithersoever the carcass, y'all know what a carcass is? A dead body. That's what a carcass is, a dead body. Whithersoever the dead body is, there shall also the eagles be gathered together. Whithersoever the dead body is, there shall also the eagles be gathered together. Whithersoever, listen, the carcass. Jesus is hanging on the cross, and they thought they were destroying him, but they were just illustrating who he is and who we were too. They hung him, huh? You hear me, Ty? They stretched him wide. They thought they were stretching his hands out, but they were actually stretching his wings out. He died. He hung his head, and then he died. That's love. They thought they were stretching his hands out, but they were really stretching his wings out. They thought they had killed the Christ, but they had really prepared an eagle. And they took this eagle down, put him in a borrowed tomb. And all Friday they praised and partied because they had killed the eagle. Saturday, they celebrated and had an after party because they had killed the eagle. But early the third day morning, he came flying out of the grave. They hung him high, stretched him wide. He hung his head. For me, he died. That's love. But that's not how the story ends. The third day morning, he rose again. That's love. So my brothers and sisters, as we began to work through this series on the eagle, I want you to take some principles home with you, and don't put them in your iNotes, don't put them in your iPad, don't put them in your journal, put them in your heart. Because by the time we get out of this series, I want you to know that you were born to live in high places. Anybody ready to live in some high places? Come on, talk to them. Come on, talk to me. Anybody ready to live in some high places? Come on up. Come on up. That's love. Come on, let's worship him all over the building. Just spread your wings. Lift your wings in the air and begin to worship. Come on, musicians. They hung him high.
They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head for me.
Worship him all over the building.
They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head.
somebody. That's not how the story is.
The story is in 3 days he rose again. That's love.
Grab somebody's hand. Grab somebody's wing all over the building. Grab somebody's wing all over the building. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. I'm going to ask that while we're doing invitation, I'm going to ask nobody leave, okay? Let's get some people into the kingdom of God, because there's some people here that you're holding hands with, that you're holding a broken wing. Life has broke their wing. Life has pulled some feathers out. Life has bruised them. But today, God's going to fix that which has been broken. And he's going to replace that which has been lost. Some of you that are in this place, God is trying to turn you into an eagle today. You've been trying to fly with your own strength. Somebody's told you that you were destined to be a buzzard. Somebody told you were born with a chicken mentality. Somebody told you had the purpose of a pigeon. But the devil is a liar. God says you're an eagle. Even with a broken wing, you're an eagle. Even with feathers that have fallen out, you are an eagle. And God's going to cover you. But you gotta wanna be covered. So if you're in this place, you're not 100% sure that you're saved. You're 99% sure that you're saved. But there's that small percentage that say, Pastor, I don't know, man. I don't know if I died right now, if I would go to heaven or not. Pastor, you don't know what I've done, man. I've done some crazy stuff in the past, and I ain't talking about last year. I ain't talking about last month. I ain't talking about last week. Pastor, I did some crazy stuff at the tailgate. I did some stuff, crazy stuff last night, man. I woke up in a crazy situation. You don't know what I left to come to church today. I left out of sin just to get to church today. Where religion will tell you you're not worthy, but relationship will say, come just like you are. Because your sin cannot stop the master's purpose on your life. But don't sit in it. If you sit in it, you're on your own. But if you will come to the Savior, if you will come to the master today and say, cover me with your wings, he'll save you today. Erase your slate as though you've done nothing wrong all of your life. He will save you today. He'll fix you. He'll clean you up. He will fix it as though it never happened, my brothers and sisters. And the next thing you know, you'll be flying right into your destiny. My brothers and sisters, I offer Christ to you. If you don't know where you would be 5 seconds after you were to die, you don't know if you'd be in the presence of God, worshiping God like we're worshiping him now, or you would be in hell wishing you to take advantage of a moment like this. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. Second group of people, you say, hey, Pastor, listen, man, I'm saved, but I need a church, and I know this is the one I'm supposed to be a part of. Will y'all love me? We will love you best as we can. This is not a perfect church, but we do serve a perfect God. And so this is the place we would love to cover you. Third group of people, you're saying, hey, Pastor, listen, I'm saved and I have a church, but it's in another city, man. Stacy Spencer is my pastor in Memphis. Bishop Walker is my pastor in Nashville. Kevin Adams is my pastor in Chattanooga. Jamal Bryan is my pastor in Baltimore. Ronald Gobby is my pastor in North Carolina, but I'm going to be here. I'm in college, or I'm working, and I'm going to be here for a couple of years. Man, I need to be covered until I go back to my other church. I want to come under watch care. Yes, this is your moment. This is your time. So if you're in one of those three categories, number one, you're giving your life to the Lord Jesus Christ for the first time. Number two, you're being restored and you're coming up under this ministry. Or number three, you're coming under watch care. Perhaps you're a college student or perhaps you're working. When I count to three, I just want you to squeeze that eagle's wing as tight as you can, saying, hey, God is talking to me. I'm not going to ask you to come and sit down in any red chairs, and we're not going to ask you to give your testimony. We've got to get out of here. But the truth of the matter is, God will know your heart, and he will respond to you as you respond to him. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come unless he be drawn by you. It's on you, God. One, don't let the enemy keep you bound another day of your life. If you heard the voice of God, you know I'm talking to you. When I count to three, I want you to squeeze that neighbor's hand. This may be the only opportunity you get. Two, pride cometh before destruction and a haughty heart before a great fall. Don't allow a buzzard, a crow, or a pigeon to keep you from walking into your eagle status. One, two, three. Squeeze that hand if I'm talking to you right now. Squeeze it right now. Right now, right now, right now. That's why this urge is all over you right now. That's why it's so heavy upon you right now, because this might be your last time. Squeeze it right now, right now. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come unless he be drawn by you. If somebody squeezed your hand, I want you to lift that hand straight up in the air as high as you can. I see one eagle. I see two eagles. See three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Eagles are everywhere. Whethersoever the carcass is, there shall also the eagle be gathered together. If somebody raised your hand, or if they raised yours, or if you wanted to raise somebody's hand, but you were just too nervous to do it, you thought you'd be by yourself, I want everybody that has a lifted hand and everybody that should have lifted their hands to meet me at this altar as quickly as you can. Let me just pray for you. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
Oh, Jesus wins.
Come on, y'all ought to be praising God there. The eagles are gathering around the carcass. Come on, people of God. That's love. Come on, the eagles are gathering around the carcass. Woo. Yes, God. The eagles are gathering around the carcass. Yes, Lord. They hung him high, they stretched him wide. Just one more time.
That's love.
Come on, let's give him praise.
They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head. For me, he died. That's love.
Would you thank God for the eagles that have gathered around the carcass? Lift your hands, eagles. Lift your hands, eagles. Lift your hands, eagles. For those of you that are yet still in the congregation, we want you to stretch your hands towards my brothers and sisters that are at the altar. You see, most of the time when you get this many people pray for you at one time, you are in ICU. Did you know that? When you get this many people to pray for you at one time, we don't know if you're going to live or die.
When you get this many people to pray for you at one time, more than likely you're in your fourth stage of cancer. But God has hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people praying for you right now because you just gathered around the carcass. Because you just made the best decision of your life. So everybody's going to pray this prayer with me all over the building. I ain't going to keep you long. I got to go preach. And they got to go with me, so they can't even sing long. Everybody repeat this prayer for me, with me. Say, Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for this day. I believe by faith that Jesus Christ died for my sin. Early the third day morning, he got up with all power and healing in his wings. I'm saved. I am saved. And I am safe in Jesus' name. Shout like you know you're about to live in some high place. Yes, God. Holler as loud as you can, high places. Holler as loud as you can, high places. Starting from the bottom, but I'm here. Hallelujah, high places. You all have made the best decision of your life. Only thing we want you to do is fill out those cards. Let us pray for you. We ain't going to stalk you. This ain't no bad Lifetime movie. I promise you that. You're going to want to be bothered with me more than I want to be bothered with you. I promise you that. This ain't going to be no bad Lifetime movie. We're going to call you one time, and we're going to pray for you, and then you're gonna take it from there. All right? You're going to take it from there. Would you thank God for them as they go back to their seats? This is the best day of their life. God bless you. I love you. I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. Didn't we have a great service? And it ain't even over yet. It ain't even over yet.